entered the home stretch for the AHSP, and I appreciate the people who are staying through. Our speaker this morning is Guy Brandenburg from NOVAC, but primarily National Capital Astronomers.
Both.
But mainly famous for his very valuable work running the telescope making facility at Chevy Chase.
Okay.
Community Center.
Right.
Guy's a retired DC teacher, which is in and of itself a horrible thing to
do. Survived.
Career. And I survived, yes.
And survived and actually did good work with teaching and motivating him in science. So he's going to talk to us about his experience in managing telescope making, which I'm sure everybody will be able to make a 14-inch diamond.
Well, we'll talk about that. Yeah, that's me trying a shortcut, and we'll show you a video of that, a shortcut of the grinding. But how many of you saw Rod Molise's talk? Quite a few of you. Okay. And actually, I shouldn't call him Uncle Rod, because I calculated he's exactly the same age as me. But in any case, I always wanted a telescope as a kid, but, you know, and I love science and math, but... you know, as he pointed out, those telescopes, like, whoopsie, I'm pushing the wrong button. Let's see, I should have tried out the laser pointer. Let's see, there we go. Okay, so this one here, it's like the cost of a, you know, pretty much a brand new car. And this one too. And, you know, when I was a kid, I used to lust over these advertisements. How many of you lusted over those advertisements? All right. But, you know, on a paper route,
or... the two that were out on the field also. Yeah. There were two here.
Okay, well, that was many moons ago that I was lusting. But, you know, no way I could afford that. And later on, you know, when I became a teacher, it's not quite a vow of poverty because it's kind of surprising I'm making more money than most people in the country, but still, you know, with kids, couldn't justify that. And I always really, really liked working with my hands and grew up on a farm and did stuff. And, you know, really, you know, it's still true. A telescope was one of the easiest actual scientific high-precision instruments that you can make by yourself. And looking at stuff out in space is really, really enjoyable. And there's a huge wow factor. Actually, let me see. How many people here, any engineers out here? Okay, only three, all right. Anybody have experience with carpentry? Okay, a lot of people. Anybody experience with, say, welding? Okay. Electronics, all right, okay. You could teach me stuff about that. All that stuff actually comes into play. And I learned a lot of those stuff by, you know, doing this stuff, those skills that I was mentioning. All right, so as a kid, yeah, I made fireworks, I made rockets. Well, I tried a cloud chamber, and I tried a transformer. Made a crossbow, chemistry set, played with those. How many of you made crossbows? Okay. Played with chemistry sets? Okay, how about, who else made fireworks? Okay. And survived, yeah, okay.
Say what? Still
have hands to raise, so we can't go on that valley. Oh, well, okay, actually, remember the title of this talk was Mishaps? This hand's normal, right? This one here, not so much. That's an unfortunate accident that I had at the Chevy Chase Community Center. Not knowing that you can't treat a table saw like a band saw. Surgeons today can do amazing things. You know, you've all been to Korean barbecue, right? Okay, that's what this stuff looked like before it was cooked. Amazing. So, yeah, I did all that stuff when I was a kid. The cloud chamber and the transformer failed because I didn't understand enough physics. Yes, I did the DC transformer, and I used up, you know, I'd spent most of my allowance on this big bulky dry cell and made the windings, right? And I couldn't figure out what it wasn't getting anything out. I didn't realize it had to be alternating current. Yes. Oh, well. But there went the allowance, right? Because that shorted out the battery. Oh, well. Some experiments didn't get repeated. And I'm still trying to get a cloud chamber to work. Oh, well. And but I lusted over also over these diagrams. Anybody recognize what those this picture comes from?
Amateur scientists.
That's right. Yeah. And those are beautiful pictures that C.L. Stong, was it? No. Or was it Roger Hayward? Oh, well, whatever. But they're beautiful. But later, after trying those, I realized that those were just experiments. Those were not the finished things. Sometimes they worked, sometimes they didn't, when we made an anti-gravity machine. But in any case, so I left it after, and I read this book after having done some home improvement stuff, hanging doors and various other different things. And my version was the Book of the Month Club, Astronomy Club version, so it looked a little different. Okay, that's how it works. But I made this one right here. And, darn thing worked good. My plan was really to buy the mirror and put it into the telescope, and Jerry Schnall, which you'll see a picture of, convinced me to actually try making the mirror. I said, "Oh, it's going to come out like crap, but I'll give it a try." But I was really surprised. Like I was saying, I've done all that type of stuff, but this is Jerry Schnall, right? Oops, come on. Keep pushing the wrong button. Oh, here we go. That's Jerry Schnall. He's now deceased. He would be about 100 today. And this, anybody recognize him?
John Thompson.
John Thompson, yes. He came to our workshop once. And that is me pouring a pitch lap. And I'm sorry about my hand shaking. That just happens. And Dobson said I was doing it all wrong. But, oh well. But I learned a whole lot from those guys. And so when I took my 6-inch to a star party, both at Crockett Park and the one that NCA runs in Rock Creek Park, people are coming around and saying, "You know, guy, this is actually the best one here on the field." And I went around and looked through the other ones, and it was. I was really surprised. I did not expect that at all, because I had made a bunch of chips on the side of the mirror and so on. And he said, "Well, you got a little divot in the middle, but that's going to be covered by the secondary. It'll be fine." And it was more than fine. And so I don't know if you've heard of Brashear. He was, along with Alvin Clark, one of the best telescope makers of the late 1800s, early 1900s. And I took my 8-inch up to Andover because I was doing a math teacher's convention up there in 94. Had anybody else witnessed some of that stuff of the Shoemaker-Levy? Okay, that was fun. And so this was inside their little dome, and I was outside on the roof. And, there's a little bit better. But, And again, I took mine up to, I think it was called the Mason-Dixon Star Party, and Marty Cohen had his, anybody seen his 8-inch astrophysics refractor? I think it was $35,000 at the time. And, my 8-inch wasn't too much worse. And I also had great fun redesigning mine to my 6-inch to sort of like, sawing the woman in half sort of thing. And so the middle part and the base made it so that they all fold down, put in luggage, and take the other part, the front and the back, put it under the seat in front of me. And so it was the biggest scope on this expedition to the 94 solar eclipse. Pretty crude looking, but boy, if anybody had the experience of going south of the equator, oh, if you get the chance, do. And get out into the back country where you can actually see the skies. They got all kinds of deep sky stuff. I mean, it's pretty wonderful here, but down there, you're looking up at the center of the galaxy, and they've also got two other galaxies, large and small Magellanic clouds. I hope to go back someday. So that's my 8-inch, and anybody want to guess where the color came from? Came from Heckinger. You know, they have those oops paint colors. I got 3 gallons of it, $5 a gallon. And so these are kids at Cardoza High School, and their teacher brought them in. Almost every single one of those kids is immigrants. And I have not seen Greg Peeple in a long time. Anybody heard from him in a while? Well, he made a scope at our workshop, and boy, did he do a fantastic job with the coloring. I mean, the covering that. Just great optics. He finished that really, really nice. Obviously, his handiwork is much prettier than mine. Oh, well, I'm not jealous. And this is my homemade 12.5. And actually, I was starting to make the thing, then I realized this piece of glass that I'm working on has interesting markings on the side, so I put that on the ATM list. Turned out it was worth thousands of dollars, just the glass, because it was some kind of optical glass that somebody had given to me. So I traded somebody for an F5 finished mirror, and this, oopsie, sorry, wrong button. So this gal did the sewing of this shroud, and you know why there's that gore there, I guess it's called? Because I miscalculated on the, when I went to the fabric store. Oh well. And this is this guy's name, I've forgotten his name now, but that's his telescope. I like the colors, don't you? And now this one, this is an interesting story here. This fellow, this is an interesting tube. This is aluminum, and somebody had welded that to make a like a 8-inch F11 telescope. Think about that. That is a really long telescope, and they were going to make it with all that, so they gave up and started making airplanes you could fly yourself instead. Much easier, I guess they thought. And one little innovation, you see this tent here. This is where we do the polishing now, because we found that if you didn't, and this is a wood shop / metal shop, that people were getting scratches. So we bought this tent, and it's really, really helped a lot. And he made that mirror that you see down the end of the tube. And this young lady started this when she was, I think, about 10, with help from her mom, and took a couple years off, and then finished it, and did a really, really nice job. She went to an outreach we had down at the Washington Monument grounds, and nice young lady, too. And this is an interesting project. This is a corrected Dahl Kirkham, and if you know anything about optics, and if you, who here's done algebra 2 or the equivalent? Okay, so you know about the conic sections, all right. So this one has an elliptical figure on the primary, and he was able to get a lens of the proper shape off the shelf, so he didn't have to spend an arm and a leg on that. And it was really interesting, you know, an ellipse has 2 focal points. And so you put a light source at one of the focal points, put the mirror where it's supposed to be, and then you test at the other focal point. And it was kind of interesting using the algebra that I've been teaching all these years, and finally have an application for it. I like that. The one problem is, though, that with his design, if you want to look at stuff, it's difficult, even with this neat little Crayford helical focuser. You have to go so far in to get a focus. So I think he's going to redo this with the focus coming out the side. Yes.
What is the advantage of doing an elliptical mirror versus a parabolic?
Oh, that's a very good question. The advantage, it's a lot more complicated. It's more of a challenge. Yeah, actually, you know, if you want to make your own type of telescope, I would say keep it simple. Because with this, there's so many things that can go wrong. But with a, and this is going to really one of my main points, if you want to make it yourself, unless you really like challenges, and he did, that's why he did this. Now, it's also very short. But, you know, I tried making one, and I'll show you a little bit later. When you have a really complicated project, it can go wrong. Now, with a Newtonian, a parabolic, you only really have to get one surface right. Just the one. And it's not that hard. And there's only two ways to fail. One is you give up. Number two is you drop it and break it. And both have happened. Say what? Yeah. Well, not grinding, polishing. Well, grind then polish.
Okay. Is the light passing by? Is it just getting the light from the outside annulus?
Are you talking about this little light right there?
No, that's the eyepiece.
Right.
At the prime focus.
Yeah.
Where's the light getting through to the mirror? It's not getting it from the middle.
No, okay, so. So here's the scope, right?
Yeah.
I mean, this is inside. I mean, it's not in operation. The scope pictures I had outside were too dark to see. But the light comes from...
Where is it passing?
You're looking at the back of the scope.
Well, that's the back. What's the
secondary? That's the back. The secondary is sort of where you would expect a secondary mirror to be. No, it was actually a convex surface. I think it was just spherical.
Spherical.
Yeah.
So the primary mirror is elliptical, the secondary is spherical.
Correct. Okay. Correct. There's lots of different cast grains. You can have, let's see.
Yeah.
Lots of different possibilities. Okay. So here's a finished mirror that had just been aluminized that this Jim Crowley, some of you know him, this is a very nice family that just finished. Wait a sec. That's not their telescope. Or is that their telescope? I've forgotten now. So this young guy and his brother worked on this for off and on between baseball season and all this other stuff. And they just finished this a couple weeks ago. And they even did a science fair project on trying to avoid turned edge and trying various experiments. And the first light, sorry, was on Jupiter and Saturn and Mars and Venus, which was pretty neat targets from uptown DC. This fellow doesn't look like it, but he's a Jesuit priest. And he does beautiful work, as you can see, and did a really nice job on this. He also made a 12.5-inch, and kind of talking about disasters, he was working on a 12, and we did some measurements, and we thought it was pretty good, and we were trying to do another measurement with something called a double-pass tester, where you've got your mirror under test, you've got a light source at the focal point. From the focal point to a parabolic mirror, all the light is then going to come back in absolutely parallel straight lines. Then you have a flat mirror that then reflects that back to the parabolic mirror. And the nice thing about a parabola, uniquely of all the conic sections, is it then will reflect all the light back to the starting point, and then you can test it very easily. So I had drawn some lines directly on the mirror, and we're having a really hard time setting it up. So I said, okay, let's put it in the aluminizer because we have an aluminizer. And I didn't bother erasing the lines or anything like that. And darned if the marks from the magic marker didn't sort of impress themselves in the vacuum chamber when we cleaned it off. So that meant he had to polish it some more. I felt really bad. Lots of trial and error. I've made lots of mistakes. And like, the inventor in New Jersey, what's his name? Edison. You know, you learn thousands of ways not to make a light bulb. Yeah. Okay, so here's another nice finished job. And she made that diagonal holder. It's pretty neat. Just use strapping metal there and a hollow tube and some careful work with a milling machine and end up with a pretty nice secondary holder. Now, if you didn't know the geometry, as I was saying before, if you have a light ray and pretend this is the mirror down here and here's a parabola, the light ray that comes from infinity is going to bounce at this point of tangency here and then go right to the focal point of the parabola. However, if you have a sphere instead of a parabola, the reflection off of the sphere is actually going to come down to a focus a little bit further towards the mirror. And of course, if this was a really big mirror, by the way, this is about a 12.5-inch mirror, pretend. But if the light was coming to here, you had a really big sphere, that light would come to a bouncing point there. So you'd have a smeared image, if you had any image at all. And that would be called spherical aberration. If you've got a small enough mirror and a long enough focal length, it doesn't matter. It can stay spherical. You don't have to parabolize. But the thing is, our level of accuracy has to be pretty phenomenal. I've calculated if you took a 6 or 8 inch mirror and you blew it up to a 10 mile square, like the original District of Columbia is, and you made it not a square, circle, the size of DC originally, then the error that we end up with after all the polishing and figuring and stuff is less than the thickness of your pinky over 10 miles. That's not bad for handwork, strictly handwork. Not kidding, right? Okay. Nods back there. So you need various ways of testing. Now, this one right here, I was trying one of those complicated projects. And to do complicated projects, in this particular one, I had to get a convex surface because I was trying to do something really complicated called a Lurie-Houghton. Now, Lurie-Houghton has two lenses in front made out of the same glass, and surface number one that's facing the world, the heavens, is a convex match to a concave in number three. And then surface number two is a convex match for a concave number four. And these have to be nearly flat. And by the way, if you're tempted to try to make a flat, think about that really hard. It's much harder to make a flat than it is to make a curved surface. And trying to match that convex with that concave is a lot harder than I thought it was going to be. The reason this is yellow is somebody gave me a sodium light, and that produces one particular wavelength, and so you can see the Newtonian rings perfectly. Now, if these were perfect matches, these two plates of glass, then these lines would not be like tree rings, they would be absolutely straight lines. Or if they were evenly different. They're both really nice spheres, but just didn't quite match. Then those would be perfectly concentric rings and circles, and obviously they are not, but I did do better eventually. And here's another project. I don't know if any of you know Peter Chen has been working on those plastic mirrors cast onto a mandrel, and I was trying to help out make some of this. No, this is not his work, okay? This is my attempt to make a convex mandrel and test from the back by looking through the glass at the reflection of the convex surface and then come back. Anybody want to guess why the lines look so funky? Exactly right. The glass was perfectly good for a mirror. See, with the nice thing about a mirror, you don't care what the glass. The glass can be absolutely opaque. It doesn't matter. It's just the substrate that's holding this nice, very, very thin layer of aluminum, which you can take off with chemical means. It's easy peasy. Unlike the days of Herschel and all those people, and Lord Rosse or Rosse or however you say his name, where they had to keep refinishing the mirror and then trying to get it to be parabolic. So I did not know that you couldn't do that with this. Those lines look fairly straight, except it looks like there's sort of a turned edge right there. But, you know, the overall thing should not look like that. That's the Ronchi test, right. And I'll... It depends what you're looking for. So these are fairly straight, as you can see. Not, you know, the smoothest. Now, what a straight line test shows is that you have a sphere. This, the angry spiders, what that shows is there is something seriously wrong with the overall figure. And I'll show you little movies of this later on. And this is just an iPhone held up. And with my arrangement, you sort of have to hold the iPhone at 45 degrees to get it to fit. That's why this line is at, well, not quite 45. This one could be a parabolic mirror. Depends whether it's inside or outside of the center of curvature. These little hooks at the bottom indicate that it's probably got something called turned edge, which means that your paraboloid is going a little bit like that, which is not so good. And this Ronchi test is really, really simple. You either print on a piece of transparent plastic or send off for somebody else to do it, fine lines that are equally spaced, equal amounts of black and white, black and transparent, and you send a light out through that from the center of curvature of the sphere, and then you look at the lines that come back. This was invented by Foucault, but of course Ronchi gets credit, just like no theorem in math is named after the person who actually figured it out. But it's a really simple test. It takes a couple of minutes to set up and look at, and you get a lot of information. When you think it looks pretty good, then you do a second set of tests to verify that, and there's a number of secondary tests. I prefer actually a Foucault Couder test, which you look at the behavior of the light at different places. I'm not going to teach you that whole thing. And you run some numbers and you make sure that your numbers fit a parabola. And if you are within a certain tolerance of that curve, then you are done. So this one is a test of a mirror after we've, you know, reduced the data and run it through. It's not quite a black box because I can reproduce a graph like this. So this is actually very, very good. This is 1/14 PV, P peak valley wavefront, not the, not just the glass itself, because glass itself would be 128. So this is a wonderful mirror, but
no.
Yes, he did. He dropped it on the floor, and it really messed it up. And and that was the front. This was the good side. Yeah, that was really sad. And we've put down some, padding so that if you drop it, usually nothing bad happens now. People do drop them. Now, this is an interesting one. This was military surplus. That is 20 inches across. And that was a corrected Dahl Kirkham. Not exactly an ellipsoid, really pretty far. We think it was for some sort of military thing. In fact, it has things from the what used to be called the Naval Surface War Station out in White Oak, more or less, in suburban Maryland. And so I'm really scared to work on it, though, because, right there in the center, it's pretty thick, right? Getting out toward the edge, it's, like half an inch thick, supporting that and figuring it. It's big. So I'm refiguring this out for later. I did construct, as you can see here on the bottom, that's my work, not the military's work, to support it with a whole bunch of triangles so that it at least won't deform when put in a telescope. Whoopsie, wrong button. So it's F2. That's short. Yeah. And we think it's a CDK. That's a Rankigram I took inside the original tube, which really looks like an oil barrel. That's exactly what it looks like. And so take a look at those curves there, and let's take a look at what it's supposed to look like if it was a paraboloid. It would look like that. Let's go back. Is that identical? Yeah, the secondary is definitely, but it's enough different that I took some measurements and found it was not a paraboloid. It's closer to an ellipsoid, but not all that close. Now this is that double pass thing, and Jim Crowley lent me his. I tried making one and just really found that I could only get it to work if the mirror was already aluminized. That's not much good, right? Because then you have to take off the aluminum mirror and fix it again. But this one is whichever mirror I was doing. This is the best I could do is in terms of a photograph. If the lines are perfectly straight, then the mirror is perfectly good. And that one's pretty close. Now, going back in history, this telescope here was made in either the 60s or the 70s. Anybody who has experience with plumbing probably knows more than I do about this, but that whole thing weighs close to 100 pounds, and it's set, of course, for 45 degrees, which is what this fixture is. I don't know where the heck he got these incredibly huge fixtures from, but the tube you'll see in the next picture, that took up most of my car. He gave this away. Guess why he gave this away? He couldn't get it out of his basement anymore. It had been down in his basement for 20 years. And that was a welded steel tube there. And that one is a 10-inch diameter. It's like F9 or something like that. So, yeah, for... There are a few people, like Shaquille O'Neal, right? He could do that. So I finally, I think we'll get rid of the base for scrap, but I put a Dobsonian mount and put wheels on it so we can trundle out into the yard up at the Hopewell Observatory. And it works pretty well. Could have been figured a little better, but as a daub, it works pretty well. On that rickety stand, you know, it was really unusable. Now, here's another complicated, this is that Leary Houghton I was telling you about, the well, the two lenses in the front, spherical mirror. Spherical mirror, I know absolutely is perfect. And I know a lot of the surfaces there are perfect. The spacing or something, I don't know what it is, but I took this up here, and some of you recognize Jan. This was, I don't know, this is almost 10 years ago now. The images were awful, and I don't know why. So, oh well. Okay. Well, thank you. Yeah, the shirt is history. No, they are lenses.
Well, yeah, but I mean,
are they meniscuses? No, one's double convex and the other one's double concave. And they're made of exactly the same mirror, same glass. Now, it's possible that they aren't the type of glass that we thought they were. And that would throw everything off. And of course, to test that, I'd have to chip off a little piece and send to somebody at the University of Maryland to, you know, to test or something. But, you know, not every project succeeds. And if you try something complicated, it can fail spectacularly. It was really an interesting project anyway. Did I do what?
Jim Crowley. Did you ever run that by Jim? That previous design. You said because I remember you had it up here, you were asking questions from people, you know, what's wrong?
Yeah.
So did you ever, Jim is sort of a guru that said this stuff.
I don't know if I did. Probably, but I'm not sure.
You still have it?
Yeah, I still have it, yeah. Yeah. Okay, so this is an example of what can go wrong, that they just abandoned the project at some point. Oh, this is another interesting project. That's me. I don't know if you can tell. And the reason I'm wearing all that protection is because my plan, and I did do this, is to use a diamond grinding thing, and this is a long pendulum from my back porch. And that's a mirror that my plan is to, excuse me, to grind into the proper shape, because that initial grinding takes hours because glass is hard stuff. And I'm using a pneumatic arrangement because I didn't think electric angle grinder in a bucket of water was a real good idea. And you don't want to get silicosis, so I did this in water, and I also have my bandit mask on, and ear protection, and so on. So this is the first attempt. Now here's another one. They finished this, you know, the daughter who grew up a fair amount during the project. And the mirror got aluminized and it's sitting in our closet. So, meaning they never finished the telescope. I don't know why. She's homeschooled, and I guess the project was to make the mirror. And this is our aluminization chamber. I'm older than it. Okay, we figured out it dates from about 1967, and Arlen helped, and his brother both helped me when it was developed some leaks, and I've had to replace a whole bunch of parts, like the seal down here, which is very important, and the pass-throughs, so you can send electricity through to first produce this bombardment of various ions to clean off the mirror, and then to melt and boil off the aluminum, which ends up on the mirror. And yes, it does look a little bit like a Frankenstein machine, especially with these cables and the transformer. But it, you know, it works now.
What's the maximum mirror size?
12.5, and no, we can't do overcoating. So if you want a silicon monoxide coating, you're going to have to take it someplace else. What? Yeah, and I don't understand. Somebody would really have to help me and show me exactly how to do that. And I've read the, you know, some of the papers, and not trivial. No. And one of the reasons I took over this telescope making thing from Jerry Schnall, who had taken over from somebody else in 1968. So he had run the thing for 32 years. He was getting old. He had Parkinson's and often couldn't walk. And I'd only made two mirrors and felt very, very unsure of myself, you know, taking it over. But, you know, we had all this stuff, you know, like this and grinding machines. I didn't want that to go to waste. I thought that was pretty cool. And right now there's only really I only know of two places in the United States that still have ongoing telescope making workshops like every week, and one is the one I run with help from these two guys back there, Mike Lafferty and Bill Rohr over there, and some other people who, you know, sort of form a nice club, and the one out in Chabot Science Center in Oakland, California. Anybody else been out there before? You've been there? Oh, really? Isn't it a neat place?
Oh,
yeah, it's wonderful. Yeah, they have one, and guess how often they meet? Once a month. Some months. Okay, and then they have the convention. But, you know, if you want, like, ongoing instruction, somebody holding your hand, you know, it's us too. And then there's a couple of others. There's one in Connecticut, one in Washington State. And maybe there's one or two more. Oh, that's it. I keep up with Francis, whatever his last name is. It's like once a month up at Springfield. At least that's my understanding, unless I'm missing something.
Boston ATM, and of course they want to install things, but they also have a shop at Westfield.
Okay, I stand corrected. All right, so this, can you see this little line here? That's that disaster I was telling you about earlier, with the line that I'd drawn and stayed on the mirror and necessitated fixing later. And we had a mirror grinding machine that was actually donated to us by somebody who was too impatient to do the project himself, just by hand. So we built from scratch, not according to the mirror-o-matic people's design, his own type of machine. And we modified it some because this is after the modifications. I think these are technically Lissajous figures. and that's not too bad because it's, you know, pretty well distributed over the whole thing. His sort of would only do one side of the mirror, which was not such a good idea. I'm also a member of the Hopewell Observatory, which was pretty much mostly Bob Bolster, Bob McCracken, who was the head of NCA for a long time, National Capital Astronomers, the competition to NOVAC, I guess, although they don't do a whole lot of observing, and Jerry Schnall and some other people, but those three did the lion's share of the work of building this whole observatory on top of a ridge out I-66 near Haymarket. And when I first joined, I wanted to be able to have access to a place to observe out in the woods, and also, you know, felt, again, it's a shame to have this whole place, you know, fall into disrepair. We've done a lot of work. Bill and I have done a lot of it, and this is, you know, to cut down some of the trees, because, you know, otherwise, you know, you can only look out of the area like this. But the Milky Way is a lot less visible there than it is here. And also had to do some waterproofing to the cabin, so that required digging trenches and putting us this HLM 5000 waterproofing barrier, and ended up with a strained back for about 6 months. That was not fun, believe me. And the soil there was about one-third rock, one-half rocks, one-half roots, and then another one-half sand. That was hard. And here's Bill. We were donated. So we used to have somebody in, I think, at NCA who worked at disposition at the Naval Research Lab. And you know how the government can end up, especially in the military, spending huge amounts on a project that, you know, does whatever, never know what it was supposed to do, and then they get rid of it. So they had this 40-inch mirror, like F6. So think about that. That's 20 feet long, if you could get it to work. It's also something called Servit. So it was really thick, like this thick, this big, and weighed, 700 pounds or something like that? Yeah. And so here we are trying to test it. Moving it around was not a trivial thing. And here's us putting floor into the attic of this place, which had pretty much really been abandoned. This was sort of junk pile up there. There were K rations from, I think, the 1960s up there that had leaked. So it's a lot better now. So this is us transporting that mirror. Look at the thickness of that sucker. And then we put it onto a truck, and we actually sold it to somebody, Mike Lockwood, who does really nice optical work. Anybody heard of him? Yeah, okay. So we sold it to him, and he had it sliced into a couple of thicknesses and made it into several mirrors. So we could not, I thought about doing something about it, but, you know, it's not easy. And this was another telescope that was given to us, and it looks like a dob, right? But it's not a dob. It is an out as. It weighs a lot. A lot. It's actually two handles. And the idea is you unclip these and then you can take out the mirror. And the intention of the original maker was to make it so that it was steerable and trackable and all that kind of stuff, but he never got around to making that. The optics aren't all that wonderful. He bought the optics, but, you know, for a, what is it, a 16, is it?
I think
so? Yeah. I think I want to put digital setting circles because we've got some encoders that he also gave us. Sorry? I don't recall. Sorry. Never got a chance to test it, but I guess I should take the chance. What about the trusty?
They're large.
Yes, they are. And notice it's basically sort of a single trapezoid. It's not like, you know, most trap tubes, mine, you just put in, take out, roll up. It's heavy duty. Definitely heavy duty. Made a number of modifications already. And this little thing, we were building a new platform inside the observatory so you could use Bob Bolster's incredible, totally from scratch, other than he did not mine the aluminum. Pretty much everything else. I mean, it's amazing. You know, it's a Wright, Wright, which means it has a corrector plate a little bit like a Schmidt cast grain, but different, and a elliptical primary, and then instead of a secondary, he had the film receptor at the prime focus, and it would take really wonderful wide field pictures. Unfortunately, you can't do that with today's cameras. The camera would throw out all this heat into the field of view and mess up the picture, and you can't put it outside because it does have a flat now because there's not enough back focus. But this problem here was we were making the platform and it's got a roll-off roof, and we had leaned some of the platform metal against the rails, and so we go to open the roof. We didn't realize, why is it stuck? Let's try it a little bit harder. Bad idea. So we finally we figured out, oh, let's take them down, open it, close it, and we didn't realize that we had crushed that one of those wheels, and that that motor was apparently used for the Bombay doors or something like that. So it was pretty strong motor, and it won the battle. Fortunately, I was able to get a replacement delivered to Granger the next day and to take it out and fix it. And it has on the other side an old Ealing drive, which was made back in the 60s when Ealing, an English construction firm, was getting into the educational astronomy market. And so this is 1960s technology. And I'm trying to make it so it'll auto guide, because right now it can only take exposures of about 2 minutes before the star image is getting too big. And I've wired something, but I'm really afraid to actually try it out. My engineering and electronic skills are pretty small, and I've been told you're not supposed to let the magic smoke out, right? Hard to get back in. Yeah, so I'm scared. And this is the back end, and that's a CCD camera. And of course, this is not an out-as, so this is going in all kinds of directions like this. And you see this sort of offset here, right? So that wants to point down, and gravity is a lot stronger than the little, you know, set screws. So I had to make something that would actually hold it in place. But it's been fun. And this is one of my first halfway successful astrophotos that Mike helped me with the processing of. This is not the final one. The final one was better. And you all know what that is. And one of the things I've also gotten to do at the telescope making workshop is help people fix their old telescopes. Somebody, different Mike, had an old Criterion Dynascope and probably hadn't been run for a really, really long time, and that's the worm gear. And so cleaning that up and getting the parts to work again was a challenge and fun. And another thing I do, this is sort of changing gears, is I do outreach of various types, and these are all brand new math teachers for the District of Columbia Public Schools. And yes, that's basically a protractor, and what they're doing is they're measuring the size of the Earth. It doesn't look like that, but they were doing this on June 20th, I think it was, a couple years ago. And so if you get the sun angle at noon, and you know that the sun is directly over the Tropic of Cancer on that day, and if you look at a map, what's the distance from D.C. to basically the Straits of Florida in a north-south line, do a little bit of a proportion, and you got the size of the Earth. Oh yeah, you work back at that one. Oh, cool. What do you do there? Oh, okay. All right. I keep, and Jay. Yeah. He's another member of the observatory too. And another thing I do is help people, kids at the Carnegie Institution has a Saturday science class, and so they are making their own little camera obscura. And if you haven't, if you're interested, that's a camera obscura down there. It's not a really big Telrad. And what it's best to stand up in here and point it out the window, and you see a left to right reverse but right side up thing. And we saw how a device somewhat like that was used by probably by Vermeer to make his pictures absolutely accurate. How many have seen the movie Tim's Vermeer? Yeah, it's a really good movie. And here they are making their own little optics over there and decorating them outside. And these were telescopes that were made by the kids a few years back. Problem is getting kids out to the country where you can actually use the telescopes. We've actually taken them up here one year in late November, I think it was. And of course, clouds the whole time. But we got to go spelunking. And how many people have done that cave up here? Only us two. Oh, well, okay. You got to do it. It's fun. They can squeeze through stuff that was much harder for me. I did get through it, though. And here's one of the little Yeah, he's looking through. He was not a very smart cat. He's very nice, but he's now passed away. So that's yes, those are PVC parts. And now this is kind of neat. Chris Lyons, who's making a portable, he figured out and designed how to make a secondary mirror holder. Basically, the secondary mirror was planned to basically get glued on here, and this then attaches to some really light wires. So this is his first design. Then he made another design, totally different, which I didn't take pictures of. But I think there's real possibilities in this 3D printer stuff. I don't think you can make a mirror out of it, though. So here's my question now is, where is amateur telescope making going in the future? You know, not that I can predict the future, but some thoughts, any case. First of all, if you want to make a something for imaging, it's going to be very hard, unless you're just talking about video. Bolster's project, I mean, that took years of really hard work by somebody who knows an incredible amount of machining. I know there are people who have made along the lines of Mel Bartel's projects. He's the guy out in Washington State I was mentioning. It's difficult. It is really difficult. And complicated optics and projects, you can fail. The Dobnut is just about guaranteed to succeed unless you do what? Give up or drop it. And, you know, some of you are much more experienced at electronics and drive and all that stuff than me. How many here have played with Arduinos and Raspberry Pis and know a bunch of... Only a couple people. All right. Well, and if you wanted to make your own digital seven circles from scratch the way people used to do 30 years ago, the database... Think about the database. And of course, if you want to do imaging anyway, you kind of need deep pockets and lots of patience, lots of experience, lots of software skills. But in any case, your ATM skills that you know some of you already have, carpentry, electronics, metalworking, and so on, and even evaluating, you get this mirror, you get this telescope. Is it any good? You know, somebody gave me a 12.5-inch mirror, for a Mead daub that they had, and apparently the body fell apart under too much humidity, so he gave me the mirror. And I tested it, and the Ronchigram looked nice and smooth, but then I did the other measurements and discovered it was about 1/2 wave, and that's why he could only use it basically as a light bucket. Now, if you don't want to image, and if you just want to look at stuff, and believe me, you know, we all know, just looking at the stuff, especially a place like that, is really fun. It's a really aesthetic pleasure. But then again, you can add a digital setting circles to an existing daub that you may have made, and you can spend more of your time looking for stuff rather than spending your time hunting for stuff. Even though hunting for stuff is fun and you feel really good when you found it, any friends that you bring along are not going to be so impressed. They're more impressed at looking at stuff. Now, I will say this. The moderate to small commercial optics are getting better. And they're also getting, you know, pretty cheap, actually. And even lots of little ATM innovations, like, you know, the Telrad was an amateur telescope maker who went commercial, and various other things like digital setting circles were originally made by amateurs who were very specialized, and people have taken that on. And they're not that expensive. But it's really a blast to make really high precision stuff with your, just with your, with hand tools. And now, anybody see the LIGO, the gravity wave thing? Do you remember the accuracy of that?
What?
Yeah, something like that. Yeah, you don't need that. You don't even need military spec optics, but it doesn't have to be. But it'll be still be better than the original Hubble Space Telescope. Yes. Don't forget that. For 1,000,000th.
People can read the test if it says it's not quite right.
Right. And if you look at modern amateur telescope making projects, and you know, if you go to the ATM, some of the stuff is way better than the, you know, you saw that huge, heavy thing that was state of the art back in the 1960s or 70s. It's crazy. It's unusable. You know, John Dobson was right. But I will say this. Not all of John Dobson's stuff was good. He would get people to rush through the polishing, so it basically would not be finished polishing, so it would be a very, very rough mirror. And somebody in Silver Spring brought in a John Dobson assisted mirror and telescope. The mirror I didn't have any way of testing, but it's a 10-inch mirror in a 10-inch tube. Think about that, no space. So how did he get the mirror in? They just shoved it in, and in the back of that they had a piece of plywood with some screws in it which was supposedly gonna move stuff. They don't move stuff. So once it's in there and collimated, that's it. Yeah, well, yeah, so he just wanted it done. But, you know, but Richard Berry and John Dobson really did open the way. You don't need that 45-degree angle rickety pipe mount. You don't need that. And an Altaz mount with plywood works really quite well. And it's still the case that people, you know, like to make stuff. Now, it used to be, apparently in the 50s, 60s, and 70s, there would be like 30 people a night, you know, working on projects, but, you know, now it's a lot less. We have between, you know, 3 and 10 people working on stuff. And they're not all just grinding stuff. They may be making the mount, making the secondary holder, and so on. And I also have a few videos. Patients still actually, I didn't feel like bringing in stuff and getting all messy because my car was filled. Anybody, patients to watch a couple videos?
Sure.
Okay. All right, so I get out of here, close that down. And I could not, with my ancient computer and ancient version of, all right, so you go away. You close down, and we'll look at a couple of videos. So this is kind of interesting. You do have to have good glass. This fellow, who's now deceased,
you can see the details.
one mirror. Believe it or not, at one point, this mirror was almost perfect. It's a perfect sphere, and he's working on parabolization, and then the figure started going flying. We put it away after getting discouraged, and then we pulled it out after a few years, and it has never, ever looked like this before. It is just bizarre. You can see how weird those lines are. That is really, really strange. Wow.
Now, when I was saying Bed Bath & Beyond, Bed Bath & Beyond at one point was selling these candle holders. So it was this piece of glass with sort of this big lip around it, and you put the candle in the center so that if it melted, it wouldn't burn your house down. But they didn't make sure that the glass was annealed or anything like that, meaning that the residual stresses from casting the mirror hadn't been taken out. So this guy spent quite a bit of time, and really it was almost perfect. By the time, so at one point he did one too many little grinding things, and it sort of released all the stress, and it changed the figure. And again, you only need, a wavelength of light is a huge amount here, and that's not very big. So
the surface off is what releases the strain.
Absolutely. And I was surprised that it took so long in hindsight. Now, it turns out that today's window glass is actually perfectly annealed. So you can have a disc cut out of window glass and make a perfectly good mirror out of that. And here's us trying to do the grinding ourselves of cutting out the glass.
But how thick can you get a piece of well-annealed window glass?
I can get it pretty easily for 3/8 of an inch. But, sometimes you're lucky somebody is throwing out an old tabletop that's got a chipped corner. It might be thicker. But we do not do this anymore. It is too much trouble. It takes forever. Noisy and so on. Take it to a glass shop in Belprairie Glass out in Rockville, and for a very small amount of money, they'll cut out a beautiful circle, and if you want, they'll even heat treat the edge and make it all pretty and so on. So some stuff you don't want to do yourself. Some stuff, pay somebody else to do it. And here is me at the... Oh, sorry. This is the Delmarva mirror making marathon.
Is that in someone's house?
Sorry?
Is that in someone's house?
It's in a hunting lodge that they rent every year. Yeah. Okay, so that's a 16.5 I'm still working on. And that turns out was Pyrex. I thought it had been plate, but it was Pyrex. And all kinds of disasters. One disaster was, I thought I'd checked it for strain, internal strain, because I think it was a window in some sort of optical something or other. I don't know what. And I could see the sort of little triangles where they had held it while they were heat treating it. It was probably tempered, which is the opposite of annealed. And I thought I checked for strain, and I hadn't done an adequate job, and then I realized, oh, it's got a lot of strain. And then Bill told me about this place out in, New Mexico. And so I had to ship it out to them, annealed it. Means when it comes back, that means it's lost all its shape, have to re-grind it, and so on. The Delmarva thing I'd forgotten about. They do that every year. Not cheap. Costs a few $100s. You spend a long weekend there. It's pre-ground, and you can also bring your own glass to work on if you want. It's fun. And that was where we were doing it, on this place out in the middle of the swamps that for near the Delaware River. And here's, now this is, so that double pass thing, this is what I was talking about before, and right here, this was some sort of a military thing that I got through surplus washet, and I wanted to see through this, so I had to cut that hole out, and obviously not a very neat job, but as best I could do it, and trepan that myself without damaging, I hope, the mirror behind it. But lining this stuff is a bear. Yeah, lots and lots of trial and error. And that's my forehead, I think. And here's another mirror that somebody else was working on. That's got the turned edge because of the hooks. Yeah, funky is a technical word. Now, I don't know if you've ever had the experience of flying over terrain right at dusk or right at dawn when the sun's angles are coming in very low, so any little hill or valley gets exaggerated a tremendous amount. And that's what this is right now, a Ronchi test acting like a Foucault test. And so you can see there's sort of concentric rings in this mirror, which he was trying to work on the edge at that time. I don't have pictures of finished good ones. Sorry.
I agree.
All right, and let's see. Oh yeah, here's my grinding the mirror pendulum thing. Yeah, it ended up being like F2. A little deep.
Good for a while, yes.
What?
So what is the surface that you're using on that rotary?
It's just a basically a diamond encrusted embedded saw. And it's probably not the very best thing.
You're using it with an edge grinder?
Yeah. And, oh yeah, here's a grinding machine. Oh, okay, I need to hit it again. Come on, start.
This is our latest version.
Yes, you are hearing cymbals. We share a space with music and band room. How well did it work? Poorly. Very poorly. No, this is not the one that Bob made. Yeah, Bob works fine. I just haven't done it. Because I found it was a whole lot more effective to do it by hand. Honest. Well, the randomness is not a good thing. It's just faster. You know. And you, it's not like you can go off and do something else. You have to stand there and keep adding and making sure that the surfaces don't catch and then throw your mirror across the room, which they can do.
So in a real shop, there are multiple machines running, and you go in between them and keep them back.
Right. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, if you're doing a whole bunch of them, you've got a whole bunch of machines. It was fun making it or modifying it.
What they call the curve generators for Gnomeless was a modified battleship turret.
Uh-huh.
The thing that made the drive gear for battleship was modified to grind out the deep curvature initially. Just brute force with some kind of a guide.
Right. Well,
and it's basically the same idea, but way overbuilt. That's what you have to do to hold it in position.
Right.
As you gouge out the glass.
Yeah, there's a guy at the Delmarva thing. I've forgotten his name, but he has a neat. Dave Grosky is his name. He has sort of he calls it a cosine table, and basically it holds an angle grinder at certain angles, and you move it around, and it does the job. I haven't actually tried. Okay, last video. So this is one problem we found with the polishing machine. So I'd gotten to the polishing stage. It remind me of a horseshoe crab.
It's making a cool pattern in the grid.
Oh yeah, really cool pattern.
It's called the fudge pattern. Earlier percussion is trying to duplicate. So what were the end results with this location?
Well, basically I gave up on the machine and took the parts out, and the table itself then collapsed after too many kids had jumped on it. So it went in the trash. But I ended up abandoning that. Turns out that the reason it was doing that stuff is there's too much of a distance between the sort of the fulcrum arm and the surface. It should have been like at most this far apart would have helped. But it really ended up that it was easier to do it by hand. Yeah. Although, if you want, you know, but the big ones are pretty much all done by machine. I mean, the reason I had that guy helping me at that telescope making workshop, that's one of the other things that threw my back out. I mean, pushing an 16 and a half inch thing across a tool or vice versa is hard work. How long can you do it for, Bill? He's got an 18 he's working on.
About 3 revolutions.
Which means how much time?
About an hour.
Yeah. And I was doing it for most of a weekend, and I just had to stop. I could not do it anymore. All right, so that's my little talk. Anybody got any comments or questions? Yeah.
Do you get people coming wanting to make acrobats?
I did talk.
It was all mirrors, mirrors, mirrors.
Well, I tried doing that. It is so much work.
Okay.
Yeah, it is. Very few people have suggested doing that. I was one of the few, and I gave up on it.
Okay.
Because.
So another project that can be done with common tools and not only electronics is a barcode tracker. So if you have a you've got tripod already, you've got a camera, more than likely when the lens is wide enough, and if you want to start off an astrophotography tracker is something that you can make and learn a lot of math with while you're.
It's true, and you can either also do it so that you just rotate it every, say, 30 seconds. I made one of those, and it produced pretty decent pictures. So I forgot to ask, how many people here have actually polished a mirror or ground a mirror or made a telescope themselves? Just a few of us. Okay.
How many started?
How many started one but didn't finish? Okay, I'm in that. Okay. Talk louder.
Thank you, telescopes. There are lots of large and cheap camera optic lenses around the telescopes.
That's true.
Old
How big are you talking about?
60 millimeter, 80 millimeter.
I made a telescope. I decided I was going to make a telescope in one afternoon, and I took a really big Aero Ektar or something like that. No, it was a copy lens from like 120 years ago. Yeah, right. Now, those aerial things, a lot of times are only designed to work in yellow light. So you'll have a lot of color problems if you do that. They are cheap. They're not very big, but yeah, up to that. They're also having people make them for them. Yeah, I always look out for their stuff because their stuff is very interesting. You know, sometimes it's nothing I want.
I thought it was interesting when you were talking, because I've never attempted any of this. I don't think I live in an area where people do this.
Where's that?
Cincinnati.
Yeah.
And
used to be one in Chicago.
So you were talking about you will always succeed if you do a Dobsonian or a Newtonian.
If you keep it up.
If you just keep at it, eventually you're going to get a well-figured mirror.
Yes.
And what pieces would I, because of having for the first time looked at through the Dobsonian up here, I was pretty impressed with the ease of instantly looking at things. And so if I wanted to do that, what pieces am I missing since I'm not close to your shop?
Okay, you need the grids, you need the glass, you need a tool, and plate glass is cheap. You can get two pieces of plate glass growing one against the other. You need the abrasives. You need the pitch.
Let's say for a 12-inch, how thick would the plate glass have?
I would get it as thick as you can, you know, 3/4 inch. Now, that's going to be pushing it. You'll have to support it very stably. I would use, like, that indoor-outdoor carpeting cut to size and make sure that you rotate it frequently on the substrate and make sure that the underneath the carpet, make sure that's a nice piece of flat plywood. But the testing thing is the tricky part, but there's lots of plans, and you can make the testing part for a maximum of $20. Easy. And lots of designs. But it definitely is good to get on the ATM list and take pictures of your stuff, send it to people. I'm having this problem. And people are very generous about telling you what to do.
I'm almost at retirement, so this may be something that I can
do. Yeah, you could do it. All right, well, thank you very much. Hope I didn't bore you.
Okay.
I was going to try to hook up, there's a slide that I have